What is going on, gunfighters? Welcome to Gunfighter Life, the podcast where we talk about guns, gunfighting, tactics, gear, philosophy, the right way with Almighty God at the center, Judeo-Christian values, and real-world first-hand experience. Today we're going to be talking about really bad gun choices for new gun owners. Yeah. That's what we're going to talk about. I'm blessed to serve you as host. I'll throw in a quick bio and we'll get into the main topic. Blessed to have served in military, law enforcement, combat veteran, private contractor, competition shooter, lifelong hunter, guide. Blessed by God that He got me through all those things so I could share this firsthand training, knowledge, experience with you to serve you today. Let's dive into the podcast. Really bad guns for new gun owners. Maybe not even their first gun. Like maybe they got a gun passed down or something. The first gun they're going to go buy or their first handgun if they've already had a rifle. Just really bad gun choices for new gun owners. And this came out of the Patreon chat. One of the guys said that he witnessed a guy going to buy his first gun, and it was a Desert Eagle. Oh, I think he said, bless his heart. And if you're from the South, you know what that means. But, yeah, just no. Like, Desert Eagles are a really cool gun. They're made really well. I mean, it's cool in the fact that it's a gas-delayed rotating bolt handgun. It's like an AR-15 flipped upside down operating system in a handgun. It's cool for that. It's cool that it works. It's cool. It's not practical. It's not tactical. It's ridiculous. They are not practical for really anything. If you just want one, then get one. I don't think that I have to justify why no new gun owner should buy a Desert Eagle. Now you're free. This is America. You can do it. If you can buy two of them and dual wield them in, you know, drop leg holsters. You can get the rainbow finished one. If that's your thing, you can get the gold gangster grill version if that's what you want. Like, this is America. You can buy two of them and dual wield them if you want. It's not a good choice for a new gun owner. I guess this is the thing. I don't even have a TV, let alone video games. But I guess people buy guns based on what's on a video game. And that's a cool looking gun. There's a lot of things that are cool looking that aren't practical. So, yeah, that's where we're going to start. Because that's what inspired the idea for the episode. Yeah, a Desert Eagle. 44 mag. I know there's other calibers, but 44 mag, 50 AE. Equally just bad. I mean, you're talking about like ridiculous versus double dog ridiculous. They're a cool gun that's not practical and a horrible choice for a first time gun owner. So that's where we're gonna start. Desert Eagle. Just don't do it. Not to mention if it's somebody that doesn't know how to control recoil in a handgun. If it's their first gun ever, it might be dangerous because of the amount of recoil that gun has. And I've shot a Desert Eagle. Don't have a desire to shoot a Desert Eagle. It's a horrible gun to shoot. And you might as well roll it out to the range on a wheelbarrow because the thing is so heavy. How about this one? Only slightly better. A Glock 20. Somebody's getting, and we're talking about new gun owners. I'm talking about you should never own a Glock 20 if that's what you want. But a brand new gun owner, they're like, you know what? I've never had a handgun before, but 9mm just seems wimpy. I need another whole millimeter. I need a 10mm. That's what's right for me in my life right now as a newbie gun owner. And we're all new at some point, right? We all started out new as a handgun shooter. I didn't pop out of my mom's womb dual wielding Colt single action armies like some old West gunfighter, right? That wasn't me, right? I learned along the way too. But thankfully, I didn't learn on a Glock 20. If you're considering a Glock 20 or any other version of a 10mm Glock for your first handgun, reconsider your choices. There are way better options. I don't care if you are about to go slather yourself in honey and walk through Glacier National Park, one of the hot spots for grizzly bear attacks. There's going to be better options for you as a new handgun owner than a Glock 20. Glock 20 is not a bad handgun. I'd say it's a mediocre handgun, and it's a Glock. It is what a Glock is, but a Glock 20 is not a good choice for a new handgun owner. The power to weight ratio is just bad. For a new handgun owner, no. If you want one, if you're a Glock shooter and you run Glocks hard and you love Glock and just Glock and you drank the Glock Kool-Aid and Glock perfection and you want a Glock 20, get a Glock 20. But if you've never had a handgun, I really don't suggest that you start out with a Glock 20 or any other 10mm version thereof a Glock. How about this one? If there is a gun that might be a worse choice than a Desert Eagle for a first firearm, a 500 Smith & Wesson. It's probably actually a better choice because at least it's a double action, single action revolver or double action revolver, because with a Desert Eagle, you could get so much recoil where the gun recoils back and gets aimed at somebody's head, and then sympathetic response, they jerk the trigger again and shoot themselves in the head. Like, that could happen with a Desert Eagle. That's probably not happening just because the trigger is so heavy with a 500 Smith & Wesson. That said, if you want a gun to make the 50 Desert Eagle look underpowered, the 500 Smith & Wesson. And they're beautifully made guns. They're very cool guns if handgun hunting is your thing and you just want the most obnoxious handgun hunting handgun you can get. If you want like a crew served shoot off a bipod handgun, the 500 Smith is it. But for a new handgun owner, I don't think I need to explain that. Just don't, right? Get yourself a nice K-frame, N-frame, 38 Special, 357 Magnum. Start with 38 Specials. Work your way up to 357 Magnum. That's just such a much more practical choice. Do that. Don't start out with a 500 Smith & Wesson. If you really are like, no, the only thing I want is a big bore handgun, then get a 454 Casull. Right? Get a 454 Casull, because you can shoot, or I guess if you wanted to go crazy, get a 460 Smith & Wesson, which is not a great choice for a new shooter, but at least you can start out with 45 Long Colt, which in that heavy of an X-frame handgun is not going to be bad to shoot. If you get like powder puff, cowboy action 45 Long Colt, it'd actually probably be pretty pleasant because the handgun's so heavy. Not a good choice, but at least you're not going from zero to 500 Smith & Wesson. So anyway, just 500 Smith & Wesson. Cool gun, not for first-time gun owners. I don't think even Smith & Wesson would recommend that. Here's another one that may be the first controversial pick. A J-frame. And a lot of these are recommended to first-time handgun owners and to women. And I love a Smith & Wesson J-frame. You're talking to a Smith & Wesson J-frame, like somebody that really likes them and sometimes carries them. Now, generally, I carry a full-size fighting handgun, and I urge you to do the same, but there are times when I carry a Smith & Wesson J-frame, and I carry a Scandium 357 Magnum. You talk about J-frames are bad, Scandium 357 is really bad. It would kind of be a toss-up as to which one had more recoil, a 500 Smith & Wesson or a Smith & Wesson J-frame in 357. The 500 Smith & Wesson is way more powerful, but a 357 Magnum in an 11-point-something ounce J-frame is crazy. You know, you want to know what that feels like to shoot, hold your hands palms up and then have your buddy grab an aluminum baseball bat and swing it at your hands. There, that's about what the sensation is. But a J-frame, that's an expert's gun. That's not a beginner gun. It's an easy gun to shoot in that if you mean by shoot, you make the gun go bang, then yeah, you pick it up and pull the trigger. I mean, it's not super complicated, but to shoot that gun well, it is more of an expert's gun, and I would never recommend it for a first-time shooter. So if heretofore you've recommended that to new shooters, I would say maybe take a look at that. It's not great. If you want a 38 Special revolver, again, get a K-frame or an N-frame, a medium-sized revolver, not a little baby J-frame, a super lightweight, air weight, something like that. You got a light gun, you got a heavy, long trigger. It's just, it's not a good choice for new gun owners. If it's what I have deemed like a tactical teddy bear, you're just going to give it to a woman and she's going to have it to feel good, I guess fine, just don't even load it. Maybe she'll pull it out in the person will crap their pants and run away. But it's a horrible gun to shoot. And I like them, and I like to carry them, and I like to shoot them. But for a new gun owner, no. It's not a good choice. How about this one? Heretofore, we've talked about handguns. How about somebody that's like, I want to get into hunting, and I want to get into hunting deer, elk, whatever. In America, it's usually deer. People are like, I want to get into hunting. First, I would say, don't get into hunting with deer hunting. Get into hunting with small game, and then once you're proficient at hunting small game, lower barrier to entry, then start deer hunting. However, a lot of people are like, no, I just want to hunt deer. Fine. It's America. Do what you want. Take your hunter safety, but go hunt deer. But what you shouldn't get to hunt deer is a 300 Win Mag. Right? I don't think anybody needs... you can have whatever you want. Again, this is America. If you want to hunt deer with a 300 Win Mag, go ahead. If you want to hunt deer with a 375 H&H, go ahead. You want to hunt deer with a 416, go ahead. Right? Nobody's stopping you. It's just not a good choice, and it's certainly not a good choice for beginners. If you are not confident in your rifle shooting ability and you think that the extra power of a 300 Win Mag over a 308 or even a 243 is going, that extra power is going to make up for your lack of field craft, it's not. And you're just going to punish yourself and you're probably not going to practice very much. You're probably not going to go to the range and put 50 rounds downrange in a day, shooting from offhand, shooting from kneeling, shooting from sitting, shooting from prone, because you're going to get the snot beat out of you with a super heavy recoiling 300 Win Mag. 300 Win Mag is not a bad round. I'm not saying nobody should ever own one, but I'm saying if you're brand new to deer hunting, you're like, I want to start hunting deer, and you get 50% off of a brand new 300 Win Mag in your favorite rifle that you think is going to be the best rifle, pass on that. Right? Don't. That should not be your first rifle. It should not be. This is, again, new owners. If you've hunted for, you know, 10 years with a 308 and you've taken a bunch of elk and a bunch of deer and you're like, you know what, I think the extra point blank range, the extra energy, I want to shoot, you know, 180 grain, you know, federal terminal ascent bullets, and I've looked at it and I'm pretty decent at handling recoil with my 308 or my 30-06, and I want to step up to the 300 Win Mag, and you've made an informed decision, go ahead. But if you're a new hunter, stay away from the 300 Win Mag or anything bigger than that. Just you're not going to make up for your lack of hunting ability with extra power in the 300 Win Mag. And although it's the new hotness right now, this super uber long range, dialing your turrets on your scope, and you need a carbon fiber bipod to shoot an elk or whatever the marketing is, the vast majority of deer and elk are killed inside 300 yards. And east of the Mississippi, where most people live, most deer are probably killed inside 100 yards. I'm just going to go out on a limb and say that. And I looked this up on the Google machine, and the top result, just they say average distance 19 yards to 40 yards, 25 yards, 40 to 70 yards, 100 yards, and most less. But even if you're talking 300 yards, even let's just go crazy, 300 yards, three football fields away, the difference between 308 and the 300 Win Mag for you in real world field conditions on a whitetail deer is probably academic. So just it's not a bad round. It's just a bad choice for a new hunter, I think. It's a round that looks great on paper. However, you have to actually shoot the thing and train with the thing and practice with the thing if you want to be good with the thing. And I'll die myself out here. When I was a young boy, I grew up pretty poor in the South, and I started working my first real job. This is before I joined the Marine Corps. I was a lifeguard, and I was making good money, and I saved up that money, and I wanted a rifle. I grew up putting meat on the table hunting. I was already an avid hunter, hunted a lot, took my first deer with a, or rather, I took my first bear with a bow when I was 15, 16, 17. It's probably younger than 17, but 15, 16-ish, I took my first bear with a bow, to give you an idea. I didn't own a rifle, not counting like a 22, like a centerfire rifle. I didn't own one. I grew up hunting with a single-shot shotgun with a bolt-action old 410 with, because that's what we had. We were poor, and I grew up to put meat on the table, and I literally was such a nerd when it was slow. When I was lifeguarding, I would study ballistics tables because this is like pre-cell phone. I mean, cell phones existed, but the common person didn't have them. This, we're talking back in the 90s. And I was studying these ballistics charts, and I got in my mind that living in the South, in the southeastern United States, what I needed, because it looked good on paper, was a 7 Rem Mag. I needed a 7 Rem Mag like a 16-year-old girl learning how to drive needs a Ferrari. I didn't need that. So I'm telling you because I've been there and done that. Don't just buy what looks good on paper. I've hunted all over. I've lived in Alaska. I've hunted all over. I've been a guide. The biggest rifle that I own is a .30-06. I'm not saying you can't have bigger than that, but I'm saying if you're a brand new hunter, you probably shouldn't. That's just my advice. If you want a guide's advice for free, there you go. Here's another one, and it's hot right now, so it's probably going to pee in some people's Cheerios. But at least I'm going to tell you I'm going to pee on you. I'm not going to tell you that it's raining. Right? The 4570. Just, if you want a 4570 because you want a 4570 and you just quiggly down under is your favorite movie, and I know we shot a 45-110. I know that, but it's the closest common round. Not a lot of 45-110s out there. At the local gun store, right? But if Quigley Down Under is your favorite movie and you just love America and John Wayne is on your coffee cups, a man's got to do what a man's got to do. If you want a lever action, I get it. Lever actions are hot right now. There's so much marketing right now with all the new companies. You got to have this. You got to have that. Look, this new lever gun that's been out since 1873, it's brand new. It's hot. You got to have it. Marketing sometimes makes me want to throw up a little bit, especially in the gun world. And I'm not saying that a 45-70 lever action is a bad gun. But I'm saying if you're a new gun owner and you've never owned a gun before, probably don't get a 45-70. If you want a lever action, let me go out on a limb here and say, get a 22 long rifle lever action. If you want to go crazy, get a 22 Magnum lever action, right? Once you're good with that, you want to start hunting, you want something a little bit more powerful, maybe get a 30-30 or maybe get a 357 Magnum lever action. You could debate between those two. That would be a good debate. 30-30 lever action versus a 357 Magnum lever action. Then once you've gotten proficient with those, if you want, get a 45-70. And again, I'm not for like legislation. Like if you want to run out as a brand new, you just turned 18, and you want to run down to Cabela's and buy a 45-70 lever action, you should be able to. I just don't think it's a wise choice. If you're trying to learn to be a good rifleman, I don't think the rifle to learn on is a lever action 45-70. Again, probably if you want a lever action, get a 22 long rifle lever action. Just my thoughts, but probably not a great gun for a new gun owner. It's probably something you work your way into. How about the J-frame of the semi-auto world, for many of the reasons I aforementioned on the J-frame. The Ruger LCP. You've never owned a handgun. You don't own a handgun. You don't really know the fundamentals of handgun shooting practically. And you're going to get a super lightweight, heavy, long trigger, baby 380. The hashtag me too of handguns. Right? One of them. No. No, again, if you want a tactical teddy bear, just carry it without a round in the chamber, and just hopefully when you pull it out, the person will run away. That does happen. But if you want a practical gun, and especially a first gun, don't get a Ruger LCP, and don't recommend that for a woman. Just stop with that, is my advice. Not a great first handgun choice. Also, just kind of, I would think, in most situations, I wouldn't say there's never a good reason for it, but in most situations, and especially for a new gun owner, if you think, you know what, I'm really not sure about this handgun thing, but you know what I want? A shotgun handgun. Right? That's going to fix my problem. Just throw lead everywhere. That's a great idea if I don't really know what I'm doing with a handgun. Let me just scatter lead all around. What a great philosophy. And you probably guess I'm talking about the tourist judge. Tourist judge, probably not a great first gun. Just going to go out on a limb and say that. Also, I put this out in the chat and I got some feedback from the patrons. And they said a 10-gauge pump. Yeah. 10-gauge, you really don't need that for much of anything, especially not as a new shooter. So probably stay away from the 10-gauge. 75 caliber flintlock. Yeah, I can kind of the 10-gauge of the black powder world. And they also put a 4-bore rifle, but we could get crazy and talk like a 50 BMG or a 4-bore rifle, but they're not real common. I don't think I've ever actually seen in the flesh a 4-bore rifle. But yeah, definitely don't get a 4-bore rifle if you're actually going to shoot it. If you're just a gun collector and you're like, you know what, I'm never going to shoot a gun, but I just want to collect African dangerous game rifles, get a 4-bore. Just don't shoot it. If you're getting a gun to shoot as a new shooter, definitely not a dangerous game rifle. Anyway, hope you like this more fun episode. I've been doing a lot of the episodes of Modern Gunfighting Technique, and those are pretty in-depth, like deep episodes. This was more kind of a fun episode. I just wanted a fun episode. I'm doing the podcast while also working as a professional gunfighter, because that's what puts most of the money in the bank. And I'm not really in love with money, but, you know, to buy gas and ammunition and stuff, that's what I'm doing. I'm working both jobs, and to be honest, I'm a little burnt out on it. If you guys want to help contribute to the podcast, consider becoming a patron. I would like for this podcast to become a full-time income. If you want to make that happen, support an American company, veteran-owned, small business, consider becoming a patron. Patrons get a lot of cool insider-only content. With that, your tactical tip of the day. Tactical tip of the day. I don't like to mention products all the time, but I know about these. Pretty much anybody in the military knows about these, but maybe the average person doesn't. Write in the rain notebooks. It's like a wax paper notebook, and as the name denotes, you can write in the rain. It can get wet, whatever, and it won't matter. That's a first and primary use of write in the rain notebook. They're really good, just notebooks to have. Way before we had cell phones with little text message apps and things like that, and notepad apps, we had actual notebooks with pens. You can still use that, you know. Sometimes analog is better. Anyway, the Write in the Rain notebooks, they're good for that, but also since they're wax paper and the water doesn't permeate inside the paper, guess what else they're really good for? Starting a fire if you're freezing to death and everything is wet. So that's just a secondary use for your Write in the Rain notebook. Really good tinder if you need it. And again, not like the new electronic abomination dating app Tinder. I'm talking about the old analog Tinder for making a fire. Anyway, that's your tactical tip of the day, your tactical verse of the day. It's from Deuteronomy 15. If there is among you a poor man of your brethren within any of your gates in your land which the Lord your God is giving you, you shall not harden your heart nor shut your hand from your poor brother, but you shall open your hand wide to him and willingly lend him sufficient for his need, whatever he needs. Just remember, men, this is my commentary. Remember the poor, the fatherless, the widow, the stranger. Wait, with that, thanks for listening and have a blessed day.